Hello, and welcome to the Calmcast, a time to feel calm and think clearly. I'm Claire Downham, the Queen of Calm, a transformational life coach. I was a burnt-out head teacher who finally made the journey to calm after years of trying, and I want to prevent you from having to do the same. The Calmcast is a series of short explorations, gently guiding you back to your natural state, which is calm and clarity. Just listen like you would listen to music, with an open mind and curiosity. There's nothing else to do. Now let's relax into today's episode. So today I am exploring human nature. I think most of the time I'm actually exploring human nature as it happens. But this was prompted by something I saw on a social media channel, a conversation about what would happen if everybody was kind, and a comment saying something that something along the lines that human nature would have to be reborn. And it made me really, just the phrase human nature made me really think, what even is that concept? What is human nature? And so I thought I'd Google it, because I think that's sometimes helpful in sparking off an exploration into something, just the definition of the definition of human nature. And so I have it stuck on my computer screen, so I can read it to you. The general psychological characteristics, feelings, and behavior traits of humankind regarded as shared by all humans. Now, what I find really interesting about that is that psychology as a body of work has been missing principles for most of its illustrious life. Psychologists, I think, have been trying to find those principles. In fact, some psychologists like William James wrote about that, said that once we had principles about psychology, it would change psychology completely and for the better. In the same way that principles, you know, things that are shared completely and true for all of a particular aspect of science have been really helpful in moving those scientific bodies of work forward. For example, I was listening to something this morning, and I normally talk about germ theory, which is a great example of how principles came to play and how it took a long time from when those principles were first shared to it becoming common practice. Because before germ theory, people thought that people who died after surgery or from infections and stuff, they had caught those from the bad smells. And so people would wear the nursery rhyme "Ring a Ring of Roses, Bucket Full of Posies" is all about the plague and all about having some lavender or something in a little cloth bag to prevent yourself from getting the plague. It's a bit of an epic fail, I think. To be, I think people died whether or not they had a posy of lavender or not. And the man who first said there's these little tiny creatures and they're what's causing the problem here ended up in a psychiatric unit at an asylum, basically, where he was put by his colleagues because they said he was bonkers. And that's what happens often with principles, with changes in things. People are not sure. Gravity is another great example. The earth being round and not flat. I know there's some of you out there who still think the world is flat, but it ain't. So when science has facts and principles, there is something to build on, really. And then there becomes then a consistent language about things and a consistent way of looking at things, which means that explorations into those things can be more advantageous because they have principles. Now, psychology, often poo-pooed by the other sciences, has been missing principles for a very long time, until about 50 years ago. And the reason why you perhaps don't know about these principles already is because of the thing I've just mentioned about germ theory. It took a long time for people to accept a renaissance. It takes a long time for people to accept a renaissance in any subject, really. When somebody comes along and goes, oh, no, everything you were thinking, that's wrong. Here's the other way of looking at it. And even if it kind of looks true, because, you know, I imagine with gravity, there must be more than just Newton saying, no, this is how it works, something going on here. And even though people could see it, because consistently, if they let go of something, it fell to the ground, there was still some rebellion against the whole concept of that, the whole concept of gravity. So that might be the reason why you have not heard of these truths about being human, because they're not much known about yet. I'm trying to change that, not on my own, with a massive community of people who do see this. So because if you really try to think about that definition, you know, psychological characteristics, feelings and behaviour traits that are regarded as being shared by all humans. It's really like, before I'd seen this, I would have struggled to find something that was true for all humans all the time. Initially, I thought, well, maybe we could think about those basic needs, you know, the desires to fulfill our basic needs, like eating and drinking and, you know, reproducing and finding shelter and all those kind of things that kind of fulfill our basic needs. The things that I guess you would call the kind of our animal instincts. That even those are like questionable now, aren't they? You know, we have people who very sadly choose not to eat for long periods of time, even though that's what their body obviously needs. We have people who choose not to reproduce. We have people who you know, don't seek shelter. You know, not that it's not just not available to them, they just don't seek it out. And so it seems that those things that we would have thought were instinctive behaviour traits are not there for everybody. So even those things are a bit questionable. So what is true? Well, the first thing that's true for every single human being, while it's true for them, is that we're alive. Like, there is life running through us. It's an energy. It's a power. It's that everything is energy, isn't it? And we are too. And, you know, if you're around somebody who does not have that life in them anymore, you can sense that there's something gone. The body's still there, but there's something left them. So that energy of life is running through us all. And that is, to me, our deep connection to nature. It's the same energy that runs through the weather and the plants and the animals and everything else in nature. It's that same energy. The second thing is that we are conscious. Unless we're not, unless we're made to be unconscious, but we are conscious, we're aware, that's how we bring things to life, isn't it? You know, it's, you know, where your attention goes, something grows. I've completely messed up that saying, but you know the one, you know, where you put your attention, that there is a perception that something there increases, doesn't it? You know, our attention, our awareness, our consciousness is part of who we are. And that's true for all people all the time. And the third thing is, you know, thought in the moment. Thought in the moment is happening all the time. We are thinking beings. We're not thought. but we are thinking beings. And that's another truth. And the thing that's connected to that is that we feel what we think. We're always feeling our thinking and never our circumstances. Thought and feeling like two sides of the same coin. That's how we come to feel what we feel. And that consciousness is the thing that gives the thought the energy, our awareness. And that's why, you know, some thoughts come and go really easily, don't they? And other thoughts seem to hang around because of the amount of attention we've given them or awareness. So that's human nature in a nutshell. And I love to have conversations about this, but what I invite you to do is to just get inquisitive and get curious and kind of think, oh, yeah, is that true? You know, is there something true there? Are we all alive? Are we all conscious? Are we all thinking? And that is how the human experience is created, quite simply. That is human nature. Thank you so much for listening. There's nothing to do now but bring some awareness to how this is working out in your life. Listen regularly to experience longer and longer periods of calm. This has been the Calmcast with Claire Downham, Queen of Calm. Take care and keep listening.